All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, long time. Either way, I appreciate it. Coming to you live from Portland, Oregon, trying to break things down. I got a little cold out here in Portland. Got some snow on the ground out here. Happy holidays, everybody. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. It's bowl season. Got a bunch to talk about here. Again, like I'm saying, I'm trying not to do too many videos throughout here just to bombard the feed. I'm not just doing these videos to do these videos. I'm trying to give you some quality content, give you my take on things. And again, I'm just a dude. I'm just here, right? So let's chill. Man, every time we have a new head coach, I feel like I got to do a new video. The last video I did, I tried to combine them all because it felt like they all came kind of in 1 or 2 or 3 day period. But this was a big one. We were expecting this one, just waiting for it to drop. This is Tosh Lupoi, defensive coordinator position. Again, they already have that co-defensive coordinator, Matt Palage. And then you know you're going to have Dan Lanning be basically the overseer of the defense. So you've got three minds on basically one job here. Hopefully they get it done. If the Oregon defense does not come through with this group on it, I don't know what we've got to go for. So anyway, I do think it's a cool opportunity to talk about him for a little bit, and then also just kind of continue to talk about their recruiting. Oregon recruiting is still something we got to continually talk about and going forward. This is a really heavy recruiting coaching staff, so we're going to see a good recruiting coaching staff. We'll see how they do on the field. Kind of maybe similar to that crystal ball staff where he had some question marks on the field coaching-wise. And then we got the Alamo Bowl. Dan Lanning's going to call the plays for Georgia. So we got a bunch of stuff to talk about. So let's go ahead and jump into it. First thing is defensive coordinator. Again, if Oregon has a good defense, I think they're dangerous. I think every year Oregon, for the most part, the last 30 years or so, maybe even more than that, have proven that they have a pretty solid offensive structure and they can score points. It's just about whether they can stop anybody. And historically, they've had some really good defenses come and go. And when those defenses come, so do the wins, right? And we know this, for example, in all the big bowl years and all the years that we've had, some of the best Oregon teams coincide with some of the best Oregon defense or some of the best Oregon defensive talent. And right now, we're in that mindset where you've got some of the best defensive talent we've ever had. And what are we going to do with it, right? What are you going to get out of this? Obviously, you've had success. You've had the Rose Bowl. Justin Herbert came off of there. You have not had as much success throughout COVID. And then this year, kind of fumbled the bag a little bit at the end. But it could end up a positive note at the end with this Alamo Bowl. And going forward, you could have a great opportunity next year to really cash in some of this amazing, amazing talent that just happens to be here at this one point in time. So it is really cool to see the defensive side of the ball get more pub, the defensive side get more looks, and this is an opportunity to have multiple guys in the same room. I really like this idea. You know, in years past, maybe you would think, well, you want to give it to one guy, let him just cover the thing. But I think now it's such a collaborative effort in his coaching staff that you really want to have a lot of guys on the ground. You want to have a lot of guys in there, as many people as possible, to give you as many ears in the room as possible. Also gives you another leg up on the recruiting. I think Tosh coming from the West Coast, being a player at Cal, who's an absolute problem at Cal, 2000-2005. This guy was a man at Cal, dude. And defensive lineman, led their team in tackles, I think. And I mean, this guy was just a stud. And becomes the coach. We all know the story here. He's had a couple issues at each one of his stops early on. I think he's really learned from that. Maybe really kind of dove into the pressure, whether it came from violations here or there, or just kind of come from, you know, trying to push the envelope as much as possible when it comes to recruiting. So of course he comes with a little bit of that baggage, but goes and resurrects his career, or goes from Cal to Washington. We all know the story about trying to get kids up to Washington or whatever, but gets to Washington, kind of falls apart there when the whole coaching staff falls apart, everything else fell apart there. And he kind of rehabbed at Nick Saban University, right? So goes to Alabama, learns, you know, kind of the craft, rebuilds the image, puts himself in a great situation, rises all the way to D coordinator. That famous D coordinator game where they lose in the CFP, in the championship game. But, you know, still had a great year. That was 2018 with Alabama. They lose to Clemson in that game. That was the classic game where they just didn't score any points. You know, that was a year that Alabama had scored a lot of points against a lot of teams, and so the defense didn't really need to be that great. They did pitch two shutouts back-to-back, which were pretty big, but they just didn't need to be that great because they were so good on offense. And so, again, I think he kind of got a negative kind of a thought for that one on the way out. That goes to the NFL for 3 years. You know, goes from Cleveland to Atlanta to Jacksonville, and it was on that Jacksonville staff that was just a disaster. I mean, that Urban Meyer Jacksonville staff's one of the worst staffs. Experiences, not one of the worst staffs, good people on that staff, but staff experience, yeah, coaching staff experience, man, oh man, that had to be one of the worst. That Jacksonville team this year was just completely toxic from what we've heard on the outside. Again, we just don't know. But we're really stoked to see what he can do out here. Super intense guy, guy who, again, is just built for it, looks like he can still put the pads on and go. A lot of really good video of him running practices for the outside linebackers at Alabama. If you want to check those out on YouTube, there's a lot of really good stuff out there. But I'm really pumped. This was a guy who was a real problem for the Ducks looking down at Cal and at Washington. This is a guy who Oregon, I think, really wanted years past multiple times. And they're stoked to be able to get him right now. So, and I do think his age brings a little something to the thing as well. I think being a little bit older and having that NFL experience, I think really helps him out. So the question then is, you know, can Oregon really recruit at the same level that they were recruiting before with this Cristobal staff? Does this landing staff have the same sort of recruiting chops that Cristobal staff does? And it feels like for me right now, they are maybe even a better recruiting opportunity now. Younger guys at the helm with a lot of different connections throughout the SEC, throughout the South, ACC, Big 12, covers a whole gamut of land down there. And then I think you've got a lot of West Coast guys, a lot of guys with a lot of talent, a lot of opportunity out here who've been out here, seen a lot of different programs, how they're run. And I think a lot of that experience is a really good thing for this young coaching staff. I think this young coaching staff is going to really lean on these position guys throughout this year because, again, I don't think this is going to be necessarily that easy of a year. I don't think this is a national championship type situation. Now, a lot of Duck fans are on that level, championship or bust, right? Get us the coach to get the championship. Well, I think that kind of goes to the expectation level that people have. And, again, I think there are different levels of expectations here. I think, realistically speaking, you want this coaching staff to come in, you want this coaching staff to hit the ground running and have a great game against Georgia and kind of see where you're at against Georgia, right? And then the real big game in that non-conference schedule is going to be BYU. I mean, the third game in, BYU is going to be a big game, especially coming off what they've come off last year by beating every Pac-12 team on their schedule. If Oregon can come out, win that first game, I mean, everybody's going to have their hair on fire. If you lose that first game, it's probably going to be expected. You go into that non-conference game, you get at least one of those easy, right? That's a gimme. But then the real challenge is going to be that BYU game. If you win that BYU game, put yourself into conference play, you're at least feeling pretty good about this staff going forward. There's going to be some hiccups. And I think Oregon fans are going to have to accept that. I don't think it's the sky is falling if you lose two games. But I think the sky is falling if you lose more than like four games. And I think, you know, you could be close to that because, you know, you're playing some good teams next year and you never know what's going to happen, right? You had a crazy situation with injuries this year. Like they said, down here at the Alamo Bowl right now, you've got 31 guys that are out from the original roster. You know, it's just amazing to think about the amount of guys who have left the program, transfer portal, guys who go to the NFL, and then all the guys who have been injured. And there are some guys who are coming back as well, but it's going to be really interesting to see how this staff, you know, really puts together, one, you know, a great recruiting class this year. I think they're going to really need to rehab this class this year. They've only got seven guys in, and it's going to be really a big question mark going forward. How do they put those guys back together? And then how do they going forward, coach this year, actually coach these guys up? What are they doing defensively? What are they doing offensively? And what are they doing to get wins in the season? Because you know these guys are going to have talent on the field and on the roster. It's just about what they do with them, right? And then going forward, it's about how do you build those recruiting classes and your message together at the same time. And I think Cristobal did a pretty good job of that. I think it was very clear what he was trying to do. He was trying to build up front. He was trying to build an SEC style of play. Not the SEC that is current, the SEC of back in the day, right? 3 yards in cloud of dust. And he was very transparent about that. And I think there was also some mixed messages maybe sent to parents, sent to kids about playing time, about opportunities going forward that maybe were not fulfilled. And that happens on any team, especially teams where you're bringing in the amount of talent that Oregon was bringing in and the amount of young talent people are bringing in. So I do think you're going to have a situation there. When you come into Oregon as being the recruiting group that they're in right now, I think there's going to be a lot of competition. That's a good thing. But I think that's also, it's going to bring out some fragile players sometimes when they say, hey, man, I thought I was supposed to be given this opportunity, and now all these other guys are getting the opportunity. Well, you know, that's what happens. And that's why the transfer portal is so lit, right? Because there's so much talent moving around everywhere. But I do think Oregon's going to have a unique opportunity in the West Coast with this coaching staff. So let's talk about the Alamo Bowl. Okay, Alamo Bowl, man. This is going to be a big deal. I think, again, not that much hype on the Alamo Bowl going into it as previous year's bowl games, but still, pretty big deal. Bennett Williams comes back. He gets cleared to play in the thing. He's practicing. That's a huge deal right there. I mean, he was literally one of the better players on the defense, you know, probably top three, four players on the defense right when he got hurt. He got Defensive Player of the week before he got hurt, and so it's great to see him back. I think he's a real emotional leader as well. But I think those guys that you really want to watch out for that are, you know, playing their last game and you want to see them really be successful in their last game. I think Oklahoma's going to really try to open this thing up. They've got guys they're missing on the defensive side too. So I think the Caleb Williams show, I think this is going to be a situation that Oregon's going to really have their hands full defensively. So having a guy like Bennett Williams back on this thing, huge, huge for the defense. Just a guy who knows what he's doing, who's ready to throw his body around a little bit. Even coming off an injury, he's still that mentality. That's the kind of guy he is. He's just pumped up. He'll pump everybody else up back there. And I think that also helps with switching a lot of guys around. Jeff Bossa, obviously, he's been a huge player down the stretch for these guys. You know, he got up on the microphone today. Brandon Dorlis was on the mic today. These are guys that represent kind of the youth of this program. And I think that this thing's going in a real strong direction. Jackson Powers Johnson goes over from the offense to the defense because Popo's not there. They got another couple guys down on the defensive side. Jason Jones hit the portal. Jackson Powers Johnson goes over there. He's a big body. He's a pretty strong player, pretty active guy. So he's going to be one to watch, see if he gets any PT. They all talked about how there's been really good energy since the departure of Mario. Not that Mario was holding anything back necessarily, but just how they came back after that transition, right? And looking forward, really not looking backward and looking, saying, hey, this is our squad. This is who we have to deal with. Let's go with it. And I think they're really pumped up going into this game. Dan Lanning's going to call the games for Georgia. I think that's a really cool move. Try to get them the best opportunity going forward. Why not? He's not missing anything here. He's got himself in the opportunity to still recruit and whatnot, but he's got already guys out here doing things, and I think that's a really good opportunity for him going forward. And I think it's also kind of a nice opportunity for the Ducks, too, to have a guy still in it, it feels like, right? You get to kind of see what the kind of thing he's doing defensively. You get to watch these games, and obviously it looks like we're, you know, kind of Georgia fans going into this thing, so they have the best opportunity going into next year, right, to have the best ranking. And just kind of see what they do defensively. This would be a unique thing. Not to say that they're going to do the exact same thing at Oregon, but it would be nice to see him call that game. So super excited about this one. And then this week there's all these reports about AB and the threats he had. And James Kopiak just keeps going back to that. And, you know, I don't know exactly the details on these things, so I don't want to speak out of turn on this. But just the overall kind of like vibe against AB, I think this year was kind of interesting. You know, I think it kind of showed people's real identity a little bit sometimes when it comes to what are they there for in the sport? What are they there for? Are they there to enjoy it? Are they to support the team no matter what? Or are they really gaining something out of this thing? I think there's a lot of people who, I had a conversation with a friend, family member of mine saying, you know, he was, after the Utah game, he was so disappointed in this team. I had so much invested in this team. And I was like, what are you talking about investment? Just by watching it on the TV? Is that you care about it because you care about it? You think you care about it more than the players? Like, I think there's some people maybe out there that have kind of lost perspective a little bit on that. And, I understand wanting to motivate the players, but, like, you know, that's not really the way to motivate players. And obviously, you know, James Kopiak keeps talking about these threats going over the line or whatever, and I don't know exactly about that, but obviously that's ridiculous. But just the whole idea of, you know, when we already talked about the whole booing in the stadium thing. That's one thing. But this kind of online thing where it's like people are kind of using online to try to get at these guys and whatever. And, you know, I just think that people need to check themselves a little bit. The fans need to kind of pump the brakes a little bit, you know. These are college kids. Yes, Anthony Brown's older than the rest of them, so he can probably handle himself. He's been around a little bit. But this is a guy that came across the country to play. He had 2 years of eligibility to play. He basically wasted one of them. Sitting behind Tyler Shuck, thinking maybe he should have been the guy the whole time. Maybe he felt like he didn't really get the fair shake at the beginning of the thing, right? Waits on the thing, is a good teammate the whole way, the whole length of the thing, didn't complain about it at all, right? And then gets to the end, gets some playing time, then goes into this season with the keys, knowing he's the guy, knowing there's a bunch of younger guys behind him, there's nobody coming up right behind him, right? He's got the keys. He goes out and wins the game at Ohio State. No credit there? What are we talking about? I mean, we're talking about a guy who's done fairly well this year. Yes, he's a game manager. but he's put up numbers when he needed to. He's ran a ton. The guy's ran the ball a ton, you know, like a running back, and gotten major yardage, gotten first down. So it's like, I get it. The Duck fans are really passionate about their team. I am too. Don't get me wrong. And I've been frustrated too this year. I'm not trying to say that I'm like 100% Anthony Brown's been the best quarterback. Oh, no. But he's the Duck quarterback. And if he's the Duck quarterback, I'm supporting him. All right? That's basically all I got to say on that one. All right, guys. Hey, let's go. Have a happy new year. Let's go, Ducks. Let's have some fun this week. All right, guys. Adios.